Often in my research, I come across missing people and unidentified decedents for whom there simply isn't enough information for a full video. These past 2 weeks, in honor of May 25th, which is both National and International Missing Children's Day, I have chosen to highlight some examples of missing children's cases that exemplify this. These are children who went missing, ran away, or were kidnapped years or decades ago and may have wound up in a foreign country or simply vanished. In some cases, they may have wound up victims of foul play and their bodies just haven't been found yet. On May 25th, 1979, a 6-year-old boy named Aiden Pates was on his way to the bus in New York City. In 1979, there wasn't a lot of mass media coverage of missing children as a general rule, but his father was a professional photographer whose photos of his son, in the modern parlance, went viral. Aiden was one of the first children whose pictures were featured on a milk carton. In 2001, young Aiden was declared legally dead, though his body has never been found. Jose Antonio Ramos, a convicted child sexual abuser, was suspected for a long time, but in 2012, Pedro Hernandez, then 51, confessed to strangling Aiden when he was 18 and threw the remains in the garbage. Though there was no evidence after all this time, others knew that Hernandez had previously confessed in church, and his brother-in-law, in fact, contacted authorities because of that. Ultimately, in 2017, Hernandez was sentenced to life in prison for murder and kidnapping, with no possibility of parole for 25 years. One of the most high-profile abductions was in July 1981, when 6-year-old Adam Walsh was abducted from a mall in Hollywood, Florida. At that time, there was no coordinated state or national way for law enforcement to search for a missing child. 2 weeks later, Adam's severed head was found in a drainage canal. His parents, John and Reve, along with other child advocates, helped to form what became the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. John Walsh is a noted child advocate who has, for many years, prompted legal reform and hosted the shows America's Most Wanted and, currently, The Hunt with John Walsh. In 1996, the 1994 unsolved abduction and murder of Amber Hagerman in Arlington, Texas, prompted National Sex Offender Registry in the United States and the first fully automated alert notification system in the event a child goes missing or is abducted, the Amber Alert, a system that has spread to other countries. Today, you can go to the website missingkids.com to search for posters of missing children and find information on the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, as well as protect your own children by downloading a child ID kit. This kit has a place to collect your child's fingerprints and tells you how to preserve their DNA with an old toothbrush. I wouldn't advise collecting the fingerprints yourself unless you have training in that area, but your local police station might offer free fingerprinting. Try contacting them. Also, remember that you need to update your child's photo every 6 months. It shouldn't be difficult in the age of digital media. Remember, one of the stories in this last set of videos included a photo that was some 3 years out of date. You can also sign up to receive copies of missing child posters for your state or local area, either for your own information or to print them out and distribute them in your neighborhood shops and gathering places. NCMEC is currently switching to a new system for distributing their posters, and I'm not 100% on how it works, but this is what my inbox looked like after about 2 full days under their old system where I was signed up for 2 regions. The number of posters you receive in a single day aren't overwhelming, and you can always delete the ones that aren't relevant. The ones I've received under the new system have been much, much fewer in number. And there are the basics. Talk to your children, your nieces and nephews, your cousins, your younger siblings, about safety. This can be the basic, don't talk to strangers, but we also need to include information about the dangers lurking in the online world these days. I have a cousin who, up to high school, refused to believe that the people she met online were anything but exactly what they said they were. Since children become internet savvy pretty early these days, thanks to YouTube replacing the television as the virtual babysitter, it's something adults need to be aware of. Gamer I may be, but I've never played more than a half hour of Minecraft back when it was free, but I know 2 of my very young cousins who are in first or second grade play it with each other, and I'm well aware there's a multiplayer mode. I don't know that they're playing that when they're talking to each other via Skype about the game, but if they're playing multiplayer, how long before they try multiplayer with other people? And I doubt they are the only such children doing so. if their parents don't educate them on the dangers that could lurk in the online world that have nothing or little to do with the viruses, then that puts a lot of potential pitfalls in their way. One of the mothers attempts this education by having her daughter watch the show Catfish. While I'm not positive I agree with this approach in a child that young, it's certainly an approach. I'm not suggesting a state of complete paranoia. I think it's also important for children to be exposed to the world, but safely, aware of the dangers therein. But at the same time, I don't have any children, so perhaps I'm not the best person to give advice. I have taken my share of child development and psychology courses in college, but they're no substitute for experience. In my own life, I've observed that the children more likely to either rebound and rebel, or have a difficult time adjusting to life as an adult or in college, are the ones who come from overprotective parents. Like in so many other things, I think balance is the key. And, as the Girl Scouts advise, always be prepared. Thank you for joining me in honoring National and International Missing Children's Day this year. As to the lack of highlighting in international cases, it is harder to find information on these cases without a database like NCMEC, but I'll see what I can produce for next year. I'm also going to try to find a time this fall to do something like this for similar unidentified decedents with little background information. Uploading even short videos on this schedule has been an interesting experience, juggling the physical aspect of moving with gaming, activity around the house, and once my brother's D&D game over Discord across the hall. I've never picked up his raids while recording, but I picked up that, which necessitated some re-recording. So it was an interesting experience. As always, thank you for watching, and good night.